now, the greatest radio shows of all time.
Suspense.
The Shadow Node.
Washington calling David Harding, counterspy.
Classic Radio Theater.
The Great Gildersleeve.
Fibber McGee and Molly.
Dragnet. Gunsmoke.
The Lone Ranger.
Now step back into our time machine with your host, Wyatt Cox.
Good evening, friends of the Inner Sanctum.
Crime this time around on Classic Radio Theater with episodes of Suspense starring Broderick Crawford, Night Watch starring Donn Reed as we prowl the mean streets of Culver City, California, Escape Classified Secret starring Parley Baer, an episode of Sky King with the Lady Sheriff, and an episode of Claudia. That's all straight ahead on this Friday. This is the 12th day of April, 102nd day of the year, 103rd day rather of the year, 263 days left till we get to 2025. Civil War began on this date in 1861. Confederate forces fired on Fort Sumter in the harbor of Charleston, South Carolina. Confederate forces under General Nathan Bedford Forrest killed most of the African-American soldiers who had surrendered at Fort Pillow, Tennessee on this date in 1864. In 1937, Frank Whittle ground-tested the first jet engine designed to power an aircraft. In 1945, President Franklin Roosevelt died while in office. Here's a montage of some of his biggest moments.
First of all, let me assert my firm belief that the only thing we have to fear is fear itself.
I see one-third of a nation ill-housed, ill-clad, ill-nourished. The test of our progress is not whether we add more to the abundance of those who have much. It is whether we provide enough for those who have too little.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy.
Vice President Harry S. Truman inaugurated as the 33rd President of the United States. President Truman spoke quickly to Congress.
Mr. Speaker.
Just a moment. Let me present you, will you, Harry?
Members of the Congress, I have the great pleasure and the high privilege of presenting to you the President of the United States.
Mr. Speaker, Mr. President, members of the Congress, it is with a heavy heart that I stand before you, my friends and colleagues in the Congress of the United States.
A wartime change of power on this date 79 years ago today. 1954, Bill Haley and his Comets recorded a hit in New York City.
1, 2, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, rock. 5, 6, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, rock. 9, 10, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, rock. We're gonna rock around the clock tonight. Put your glad rags on, join me home. We'll have some fun when the clock strikes one. We're gonna rock around the clock tonight. We're gonna rock, rock, rock till broad daylight. We're gonna rock around the clock.
Initially unsuccessful, the recording would help launch the rock and roll revolution a year later. Haley explains the beat in his music that he thinks led to its success.
We changed the rhythm from just a shuffle type rhythm
right.
to the heavy 2-4 beat, which was 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, get out in that kitchen and rattle those pots and pans. Whereas it used to be da 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 da.
Haley sold 25 million records worldwide before passing away in 1981 at the age of 55. The polio vaccine developed by Dr. Jonas Salk declared safe and effective at this date in 1955. And in 1961, Yuri Gagarin became the first man to fly in space.
This is the BBC Home Service. Here is the news. All Moscow is waiting to give a hero's welcome to the world's first spaceman, Major Gagarin of the Soviet Air Force.
The first manned spaceflight on this date in 1961. 20 years later, the first launch of a space shuttle, Columbia, launching on its first mission. In 1988, Sonny Bono beat out seven contenders to become the mayor of Palm Springs, California.
I feel elated. I'm in shock, kinda, because you fight for a day, you never really think it's gonna come, and then when it gets here, I really went comatose today. I became absolute bread mold all day.
It was the first step in a career move from entertainment into politics. Bono would be elected to Congress in 1994, but 4 years later, a skiing accident would claim his life at the age of 62. In 1999, President Clinton cited for contempt of court for giving intentionally false statements in the Paula Jones sexual harassment civil lawsuit. In 2000, the government announced a compensation program for persons who worked at the Nevada test site, 65 miles northwest of Las Vegas, where more than 900 above and below ground nuclear weapons exploded from 1951 until 1992.
The president, the vice president, and I apologize for the suffering these men and women have been through, suffering from the effects of cancer, chronic beryllium disease, and other illnesses, and also suffering at the failure of their government to acknowledge a responsibility to help them. It's time to do right by these proud workers.
Energy Secretary Bill Richardson, those people are still affected to this day, not just people at the test site, worked on the test site, but people downwind of the test site, the downwinders as they're called, a number not too far from me here in Ely, Nevada. And in 2009, Zimbabwe officially abandoned the Zimbabwean dollar as its official currency. I have a, I think it's a $10 million Zimbabwe dollar note, which at the time of its final exchange was probably worth about 17 cents. The massive inflation in that country just, you know, made it impossible. Passing away on this date in history, the politician Boss Tweed, William Marcy Tweed, founder of the Red Cross, nurse Clara Barton. Also, as we mentioned earlier, President Roosevelt passing away on this date. Major League Baseball executive and gum-chewing manufacturer Phil Wrigley, boxer Joe Louis, wrestler Mike Von Erich of the cursed Von Erich family, radical leader Abby Hoffman, singer Boxcar Willie, also Mrs. Eli Wallach, Ann Jackson, Gilbert Gottfried passing away on this date, and boxer Sugar Ray Robinson.
Sugar Ray Robinson was probably inch for inch and pound for pound the greatest fighter who has yet lived, period. There can be no question about that. He faced the greatest. He beat them all. And while he lost on occasion, he always made up for it. The best. That's all there is. The best fighter who has yet lived.
He called many of his bouts. Howard Cosell of ABC, Sugar Ray Robinson, passing away on this date back in 1989. Among those born on this date include children's author Beverly Cleary, who wrote so many great books. She passed away in 2021 at the age of 104. Also, musician, bandleader Billy Vaughn. Also, actress and dancer Ann Miller. The unusual Tiny Tim, author Tom Clancy. And singer, teen idol, David Cassidy.
Hi, this is Jeff Foxworthy. It is now time for the birthday announcements. The following people are now officially older than dirt.
Those who are still with us include the fine jazz musician Herbie Hancock, 84 today. He was Al Bundy on Married with Children, also in Modern Family. How did Ed O'Neill get all those parts to work with all those gorgeous women? He's 78 years old today. David Letterman, 77 years old today. Of course, Letterman doing things with more in the production end these days. He's been appearing on TBS or TNT. I'm not sure which network it's on, but they're where they adapted his stupid pet tricks into a regular show. Also, from Martha and the Vandellas, Lois Reeves is 76. Actor Andy Garcia, 68. Vince Gill, 67, the country musician. From Buffy the Vampire Slayer and Criminal Minds, Nicholas Brendon is 53. From Little House on the Prairie and 90210, Shannon Doherty is 53. From Coldplay, Guy Berryman is 46. Actress Claire Danes is 45. From Panic at the Disco, Brendan Urie is 37. Model and actress Brooklyn Decker is 37. And she had Academy Award nominations for Atonement and Brooklyn. Saoirse Ronan is 30. Though some of the people who celebrate the 12th day of April is their birthday. And if this happens to be your birthday,
happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, happy birthday. Happy birthday to you.
And now on this Friday edition of Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox, we start off with an episode of Suspense from 70 years ago. Broderick Crawford starring in Parole to Panic. That's next. Thank you for joining me for the Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox podcast. Stay tuned.
In times of economic uncertainty and chaos, your money means nothing. You may not even be able to get it from your bank or ATM. And the money you do have in the stock market will go down and down. What you can bank on is gold and silver. Gold and silver have been a reliable and trusted form of currency for thousands of years. Gold and silver have never been worth zero, and typically gold holds its value during economic turmoil. Call the Gold Hotline now and learn how to protect your money and your assets with gold and silver. And learn how to set up a new IRA or roll over your current one into a gold-backed IRA. Protect your money from the next market crash with gold and silver. Call now for your free gold guide.
800-515-6302. 800-515-6302. 800-515-6302. That's 800-515-6302.
And now on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox, you knew him best probably as his television role in the syndicated Highway Patrol, Broderick Crawford, starring in an episode of Suspense from 70 years ago as we begin a pair of shows from 1954. Suspense, Parole to Panic, as radio's outstanding theater of thrills, Suspense.
Autolite and its 98,000 dealers bring you Mr. Broderick Crawford in tonight's presentation of
Suspense. Tonight, Autolite presents the story of a man whose welcome home party promised little gaiety and many tears, and surely his death. It's called Parole to Panic. Our star, Mr. Broderick Crawford.
This is Harlow Wilcox reminding you that there's no time like right now to enter the giant Autolite family charity drawing. $100,000 in cash is waiting to be distributed to the recognized local or national charities chosen by the 25 persons selected in this great event. You may be one of those persons. To enter is as simple as printing your name and address. Listen to this on-the-spot interview with a woman in Connecticut.
Hello, I'm Bob Emmerich. What's your name?
Mrs. Allen Gulliver.
I understand that you signed up for this drawing here at this Autolite family car dealer, Salvatore Brothers. Is that right?
That's right.
Did you find it difficult?
Absolutely not. I signed my name and address on a registration form, and that was it.
Was there any obligation of any sort?
None whatsoever.
I see. Well, thank you very, very much, Miss Gulliver.
Thank you.
So, friends, visit any or all of these Autolite family car showrooms. DeSoto, Hudson, Plymouth, Studebaker, Dodge, Willis, Nash, Packard, Kaiser, or Chrysler. Sign up tomorrow.
And now, Autolite presents transcribed Mr. Broderick Crawford in Parole to Panic, hoping once again to keep you in suspense.
Well, Paul, there it is. The outside.
Yeah.
Pretty good, huh?
Not bad. Not bad at all.
Enjoy it.
Hmm?
What I mean is, don't come back here. It's a pretty good life out there.
I won't be back. 2 years is enough for me.
Taking the train to town?
No, I don't think so. My wife's supposed to pick me up if she can borrow a car.
Well, good luck. It's not going to be easy for you.
Yeah, I know.
If there's anything I can do, if you need someone to talk to, advice, you know.
Yeah, sure. Thanks, Warden. Thanks for seeing me to the door.
I like you, Paul. Don't let me down.
I won't.
Goodbye.
Goodbye, sir.
Oh, Paul, Paul.
Oh, darling.
Oh, did I keep you waiting long?
No, only a couple of seconds.
I was so afraid to drive fast. This is our car, you know.
Our car?
I bought it yesterday. It's for you.
Oh, sort of a coming out present, huh?
Don't joke, Paul. Don't ever joke about being in prison.
What do you want me to do, cry?
No, because that's what I know you're doing when you joke about it.
Come on, let's sit in the car. I still feel kind of funny about all this space to move around in.
All right. Slide in on this side. You drive.
Okay. Where'd you get the money to buy a car?
I only had to make the down payment on it. We'll manage the rest.
I'll manage the rest.
What?
Oh, I don't know if this is the time to talk about it, but I'm going to have to find a job. Can't have you taking care of me, you know.
Oh, that's all taken care of.
It is?
Yes. I told my boss what you knew about fixing radios and what you'd done while you were in the Army, and he arranged a job for you at the plant.
Did you tell him where I'd been for the past 2 years?
Yes, Paul.
Oh. I don't know how I ever got mixed up with that gang, Jenny.
Let's not talk about it.
Too bad the district attorney didn't get them all while he was at it.
It's over, dear. Let's forget it. There are other things to think about now.
Jenny.
Yes?
I love you, Jenny. I love you very much.
I'm so glad, dear.
Shall we go home now?
Yes. Let's. Tired?
No, I feel great.
Do you realize you've driven all the way from that place in only 2 hours?
Well, it's not me, Jenny, it's the equipment. You got a real good deal here.
Mr. Miller found it for me.
Does he still have the same store?
Yes, why?
Well, I've got to see him right now.
After you report to the parole officer?
No. He said I had to report to him before I went home, but he didn't say anything about seeing Mr. Miller.
But Paul...
Oh, now, don't worry, it'll only take a minute or two.
Well... All right, but only a minute or two. Promise?
Yeah, I promise.
Pick it up this afternoon. Yes, he'll deliver you a fresh dozen eggs. Good. Yes. Good. Yes. Goodbye, Mrs. Gordon. And what can I... Paul! Jenny!
How are you, Mr. Miller?
Well, Paul, it's good to see you. Well, you look fine.
I feel fine, too. I just dropped by to thank you for taking care of Jenny while I was gone. You know, the groceries and...
Not another word, Paul. You and Jenny are like my own. Besides, as soon as Jenny got a job, she paid me back.
Well, anyway, thanks.
Ah, now, let me look at you. You're a good boy, Paul. Everything will be happy again.
Yeah, sure it will. Tell Roger I was here and I'll see him later, will you?
Tell him yourself.
What?
He's here, in the back room. Roger.
Never mind. I'll go back there.
All right.
I won't be long, darling.
Good.
Hi, Roger.
Oh. Paul. Come on in. Well, it's good to see you, Paul.
Yeah, it's good to be here, too.
When'd you get back?
I just drove into town.
I'm sorry I couldn't do better for you at the trial.
Oh, you did fine. I don't know what would have happened to me if you hadn't defended me. Look, as soon as I get some money and a job, I'll pay you.
Oh, relax. No hurry. Paul?
Yeah?
Have you talked to anyone since you got back? I mean, outside of Pa and me.
No, I just told you. I just drove into town. Why?
Well, you know the DA didn't get the whole gang when they lowered the boom.
Yeah, sure. I know that.
Well, there's a rumor going around that they're waiting for you when you get out.
Why? What have I done?
They say you turned state's evidence.
But I didn't. I only told them the truth about what I knew.
I know that, but they don't.
All right, then I'll tell them.
You're not going to have a chance to do it.
Why not?
Now, understand, this is only what I've heard through the grapevine. But I hear they're going to shoot first and then ask questions.
Well, then what am I going to do?
I don't know.
Maybe I can get somebody to take a message for me.
Paul.
What?
Paul, they won't believe anything you say.
Why not?
Because they don't want to believe you. They're looking for a pigeon.
Oh, and I'm it, huh?
You're it.
You think I ought to leave town?
Why don't you go to the police? They put you under protective custody.
What am I going to tell them?
Just what I told you that I heard.
No, Roger. If the police followed every crackpot rumor they heard, they'd run themselves ragged.
But this isn't a crackpot rumor.
They don't know that.
No, but we
Look,
know...
I'm going to get out of town. Jenny's got enough money to keep us going for a while.
Well, keep in touch. If you need anything, just let me know.
Yeah, sure, I will. Thanks.
Sorry, I can't help more.
Well, there's nothing more you can do, Roger. So long.
Bye.
Where are we going?
Home, to pack.
Well, what for?
We're leaving town.
Why? Why are we leaving town?
They're after me.
Why? Who's after you?
The rest of the gang.
Well, what did you do?
I told the truth in court. They call it ratting, singing, squealing. Just take your choice.
Oh, who told you all this?
Roger Miller.
But what about your job?
I can't keep it if I'm dead.
Oh, there must be something we can do.
Yeah, there is, and we're doing it. We're getting out.
Look, Paula, are you sure about all this?
I'm not going to wait for a bullet to make me certain.
Well, all right, if you think it's best.
I can't take the chance that I could be wrong. This happened so quickly that I got to get out of town, even if it's just so I can think clearly.
Do they know you're back in town?
No, I don't think so. That's why we better hurry.
Well, where out of town are we going?
I don't know. All I know is I'd better get out if I want to stay alive. I've got to get the overnight bag filled here. Let me see. This is it, I guess. What else do you need?
Well, I'm all set here. How about your clothes?
Oh, I don't know if they still fit, but I pack what suits look to be in shape. You ready?
Yes. Oh, are you sure, Paul? Are you sure Roger was right? He could be wrong,
yeah,
you
sure
know?
He could be, but... Hello?
Hello, Paul.
Who is this?
You're gonna die today, Paul.
Who was it?
They know, Jenny. They know I'm back in town. I'll be right back. Mr. Miller.
Oh, well, what is it? You look so...
Where's Roger?
He went to court. He has a case today. Why?
Doesn't make any difference. Look, Mr. Miller, do you have a gun?
A gun? Yes, I have a gun, but I...
All right, give it to me.
What?
I need a gun, Mr. Miller. Please let me have it.
You don't know what you're doing, Paul. A gun. I'm sorry, but
I
can't...
Mr. Miller, please, it's my life. I gotta have a gun.
But why?
I haven't got time to explain now. Ask Roger when he gets back. He'll tell you all about it.
I have a permit. He'll want to know where you...
It'll be all right. Just give me the gun, please. I gotta hurry.
You say Roger will tell
you? Yeah, he'll tell you. Please, Mr. Miller, hurry.
All right. Here, Paul. I'm doing a wrong thing, but if Roger says it... Be careful, Paul.
Yeah, I will.
Why did you have to stop there?
I had to get something.
What?
A gun.
Oh, Paul, you're on parole. If they catch you with a gun...
They won't catch me. As soon as we're out of town, I'm going to ditch it.
Oh, Paul, isn't there a chance Roger might have been wrong? Maybe they've forgotten about you.
No, not with that telephone call I got just before. Jenny.
Yes, Paul?
We're being followed.
How do you know?
I know. Watch when we go around the corner. Watch that blue sedan about a half a block in back. See him?
No, there they are.
All right, now watch the next corner. Well, Jenny?
Yes. They're following us, Paul.
Autolite is bringing you Mr. Broderick Crawford with Paula Winslow in Parole to Panic, tonight's presentation in radio's outstanding theater of thrills, Suspense.
Now, we'd like you to hear a recording of another on-the-spot interview in connection with the Autolite family charity drawing. This time with a policeman in Bronxville, New York.
And what is your name, officer?
Patrolman James Morris of the Bronxville Police Department.
I understand that you've signed up for the Autolite family charity drawing. Is
That's
that right?
Right.
And should your name be selected, how would you care to designate the money?
I would split it three ways. Cancer Fund, Heart Fund, and Bronxville PBA.
Very fine. And may I wish you good luck.
Thank you very much.
Why don't you help your favorite local or national charity, too? It won't cost you a cent, and you have an opportunity to be among the 25 persons selected. Remember, there's nothing to try or buy, nothing to write or solve. All you do is visit any Autolite family car dealer showroom and fill out a registration form. So why not visit any one or all of these car dealers? DeSoto, Hudson, Plymouth, Studebaker, Dodge, Willis, Nash, Packard, Kaiser, or Chrysler. There's not much time left, so sign up tomorrow.
And now, Autolite brings back to our Hollywood soundstage Mr. Broderick Crawford with Paula Winslow in Elliot Lewis's presentation of Parole to Panic, a tale well calculated to keep you in suspense.
Well, Jenny?
They're still following us.
What are they doing? Torturing me? Follow us this closely, they can catch us anytime they want to.
Oh, go to the police, Paul. Don't be afraid.
I'm not afraid of the police. It's what's in back of us that I'm afraid of.
Well, then let the police take care of them.
Don't you see? If I go to the station and stop the car, they'll blast before I get to the front door. That's why they're following us so closely.
But they have to be crazy.
Yeah, they are crazy. But if I stop, I'll be dead and they'll still be crazy. No. No, we gotta lose them. Then we'll figure out something. See him?
No.
Good. I think we lost him this time.
What do we do now?
Well, we're almost out of gas. We better stop.
Well, all right.
But what?
Oh, call the police. Tell them what's happened.
I intend to, Jenny. This is pretty open country. I guess we better stop at the first station we see. I'll telephone while they're filling the tank.
Well, I'm starting to feel a little better.
Yeah, so am I.
Oh, Paul, there's a station.
Yeah, I see it.
will it be?
Fill her up, will you?
Right, sir.
Say, you got change for a quarter?
Yes, think so. Here. Help yourself.
Okay. 10, 20, 25. Here's your quarter.
Just drop it.
Right. Say, where's the phone?
Back to the station.
Thanks a lot. Operator. Operator, I want the police. Yes, my name is...
Oh! Oh, they just drove past. I think they saw the car.
What?
They're stopping down the road.
Come on.
14 already, mister. I don't think she'll take much more.
Hey, Jenny! Jenny, they're turning around.
Hey, mister, you didn't wait for it. Hey! Hey! Hey, what are you trying to pull? Hey! Hey!
How'd they find us? How?
I don't know. I don't know.
Oh, Jenny. Jenny. Oh. Jenny,
what?
Listen to me.
What is it?
This car isn't fast enough to stay away from.
Well, then what'll we do?
I'm going to turn in the first side road we come to, and then you're getting out.
No. No, I won't do it.
You got to. I can't.
I'm not getting out of the car.
Jenny, they'll kill you, too.
I don't care. I've been away from you long enough.
All right, then we'll keep going.
Do you know where we are?
Yeah. Yeah, there's no way we can get back to town from here.
It'll be dark soon.
I know that.
Maybe we can get away then.
Catch up to us before dark. They can catch us anytime they want to.
Paul, do you know where we are?
I told you before, Jenny.
No. I mean, do you remember the cabin where we spent a weekend, the first winter we were married?
Yeah, why?
Well, it was on a road that turned off this one, wasn't it?
Yeah, I think so. I'm not sure. We got that cabin from one of the boys. Do you remember?
Yes, but it's better than sitting in the car and waiting for them.
Okay, let's go. You remember where the side road was?
Well, it pretty soon now, I just past a bridge, I think.
Oh, Jenny, I hope you're right.
Oh, I do too, Paul. I do too.
It's locked.
I don't have a key.
All right, I'll kick it in.
Hurry, Paul. I hear them.
Yeah, so do I. Step back, Jenny. All right, stay away from the windows. There's enough light yet for him to shoot. Let's push this table against the door. Come on.
Okay.
Here they are. Okay, Jenny. You stand over there. As soon as they come up the steps, I'm going to start shooting.
Maybe they're afraid.
No, they couldn't be. Because they know I am.
What are they waiting for?
I don't know. They haven't even gotten out of the car yet.
Do they know you have a gun?
Oh, I don't know. I don't think so. I wish they'd do something.
Paul.
What? Wait. Wait a minute. They're on their way.
Paul.
What?
There's a telephone in the cabin.
Where?
I think it's in that cabinet on your left.
Okay. Yeah, here it is. Hello? Hello? Hello, operator. It's disconnected.
Did you say it was disconnected?
Either that or they just cut the wire. Yeah, that's what happened. One of them just cut the wires.
Where are they going?
I don't know.
Maybe they changed their minds, huh?
But I doubt it.
Well, then why would they drive away?
Well, they didn't go far.
But why did they go at all?
They're not sure whether I got a gun or not. If I have one, they know they're asking for it if they rush the cabin.
How long can we stay here?
Jenny, we're leaving now.
But you said they're just down the road.
We're going to leave on foot.
What?
Tell me, can you walk much in those shoes you got on?
But yes, the heels are pretty low. Why?
All right. We'll head into the woods. Go east as far as we can. We'll sleep out in the open tonight. And we'll head for the first house we see when daylight hits.
All right, Paul.
I'm going to go out first. You follow me in a couple of seconds.
Yes.
Now help me with this table in front of the door. I don't want to slide it.
All right.
It looks clear. A few seconds, Jenny, remember that. Then follow me.
I will.
They suckered me, Jenny. They had a guy planted out there.
Oh, you're bleeding, Paul.
Yeah, I'm hurt. I'm hurt bad.
We gotta try to stop the bleeding.
Try all you want to. I don't think you can do it.
But we've got to try.
They're back to pick up the body. Sure gonna be disappointed, aren't they?
Oh, Paul, I'm frightened. I don't know what to do, and I don't know how to help you.
Just stay close to me, Jenny. Stay close. I'll think of something.
Paul?
Yeah, Jenny?
Are you...
Yeah. Yeah, I'm still bleeding.
Let me talk to them. They'll listen to me. I'm a woman. You've got to get a doctor.
No, Jenny. That's what they want, don't you understand? They want me to die, and I'm going to.
Don't say that, Paul. Don't say that.
It's true, Jenny. It's true, but... Well, I'm not going to die alone.
What are you going to do?
They haven't gotten out of the car since they came back. That means they're all together. Well, I still got 4 slugs left in the gun. I'm going to use them. Get back, Jenny. I got to break this window. You out there. Why don't you come in and get me? All right, I'll come out and get you.
Easy, Paul. Take it easy. You're going to be fine.
Who are you?
Police.
Jenny. Where's Jenny?
Here I am, darling.
When did they get here?
Just after you came out shooting.
How did you find me?
Roger Miller called us after you got the gun from his father.
But how did you know where to look?
You left the receiver off the hook in the service station. There we checked all the side roads looking for a big gasoline stain where you might have turned off the main road.
Gasoline?
The attendant was still pumping gas into your car when you drove away. He never got the chance to replace the cap on your tank.
Oh. We'll pick it up some other time. Won't we, Jenny?
Yes, Paul. We'll pick it up some other time.
Suspense. Presented by Autolite. Tonight's star, Mr. Broderick Crawford. This is Harlow Wilcox again. Whatever your favorite charity, local or national, you may help it collect thousands of dollars by just printing your name and address.
That's all you do to enter the Autolite Family Charity Drawing. And if you are one of 25 chosen, you'll name any recognized charity you wish for a share of $100,000. Your friends and neighbors are signing up enthusiastically. Listen to this typical comment by an Elizabeth, New Jersey woman.
This is Mrs. Morris Cohen, who just signed up for this drawing. Now, Mrs. Cohen, when you signed, did you have any difficulties whatsoever?
None at all. Just sign my name and address.
I see. Should your name be selected, how would you care to designate the money?
Three chapters in Elizabeth. The cerebral palsy, the heart fund, the cancer.
I think that's wonderful, and may I wish you good luck.
Thank you.
So give your favorite recognized charity the opportunity of a lifetime. Sign up at any or all of these Autolite family car showrooms. DeSoto, Hudson, Plymouth, Studebaker, Dodge, Willis, Nash, Packard, Kaiser, or Chrysler. Do it tomorrow, sure. And now, Betty Goody of Radio TV Mirror Magazine and the producer of Suspense, Elliot Lewis.
It is my pleasure, Elliot, to inform you that the readers of Radio TV Mirror again have selected Suspense as their favorite radio mystery program. Here is your award, a gold medal and a scroll, and congratulations to you and Autolite.
Thank you very much, Betty, and thanks also to all you Suspense listeners who voted for us.
You'll find an interesting story and pictures on the annual awards in the current issue of Radio TV Mirror magazine.
Next week, the story of a man who tried to learn a lesson the hard way. He bet his life on the turn of a card. It's called The Card Game. Our star, Mr. Richard Widmark. That's next week on Suspense. Suspense is transcribed and directed by Elliot Lewis, with music composed by Lucian Morowick and conducted by Lud Gluskin. Parole to Panic was written for Suspense by Ross Murray. In tonight's story, Paula Winslow was heard as Jenny. Featured in the cast were Joseph Kearns, Junius Matthews, Hi Averbeck, and Barney Phillips.
Broderick Crawford may soon be seen co-starring with Gregory Peck in the 20th Century Fox picture, Night People.
And remember, next week, Mr. Richard Widmark in The Card Game.
This is the CBS Radio Network.
From 70 years ago, the first of two shows from April 12, 1954, Broderick Crawford in Suspense. You're listening to Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. In just a moment, we'll take you to Culver City, California for an episode of Night Watch. But in a moment, the news from this date, 70 years ago today.
Are you suffering with anxiety, depression, PTSD, an eating disorder, or even a substance abuse problem? If it's causing problems at work or with your family, get help now. At Insight Mental Health and Wellness, we help and treat all types of depression and mental issues. We will help you use your insurance to get away from it all, to a beautiful, sunny, and tranquil vacation-like environment, so you can recharge yourself. And with the Family Medical Leave Act, you could take the time off you need from work. Plus, with the Affordable Care Act, your treatment could be 100% covered. If you're suffering from any kind of anxiety, depression, PTSD, eating disorder, or even a substance abuse problem, use your insurance and get away from it all. Come to sunny California. Call Insight Mental Health and Wellness now.
800-281-8944. 800-281-8944. 800-281-8944. That's 800-281-8944.
Thanks for joining us for Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. We're listening to an episode of Suspense, and next up will be an episode of Night Watch as we do this 2 hours of crime. These first two shows came from this date, Monday, April 12, 1954. We're going to take a look at the news of that date 70 years ago today. A condemned killer mowed down by submachine gun bullets after staging a fantastic escape from the Trenton State Prison death house in Trenton, New Jersey, died early yesterday before he could keep a date with the electric chair. John L. Vashorich, scheduled to walk the last mile the week of April 25th for a robbery killing, engineered the break with the help of two other condemned killers, but never reached the 30-foot walls to freedom. One guard suspended yesterday pending a very thorough inquiry into the first escape from the prison death house since 1922. Ex-Premier Mohamed Mosegi maintained last night he is still on a hunger strike, but his chief prosecutor branded him a secret cookie nibbler. Mosegi, whose one-session boycott of the Army Appeal Court petered out when six officers fetched him from his room yesterday, appealed to the court, "I can't stand up any longer. I'm too weak. Can I sit down and read my bill? I've not eaten." But Brigadier General Hussein Anemon, the prosecutor, told the court he's been eating. He ate sweets last night in the darkness. Later, he told a reporter he eats cookies, chocolate, and vitamin tablets when the guards aren't looking. The attractive platinum blonde hid out in jail yesterday, convinced that only there was she safe from Soviet agents, although no authorities seemed to believe her story about once being a Russian spy. Federal officials said they only saved her a cell because she's awaiting deportation in California for pro-communist activities. She was arrested in Washington Friday night for leaving the West Coast without permission. Just how long Ludmila Mikhailov, the 24-year-old blonde, plans to stay behind bars, still something of a mystery. Her attorney, John W. Brennan, explained she probably could be released on a $1,000 bond anytime she wishes, at least until April 20th, when a hearing will be held on the charges of her leaving California. A 107-year-old Confederate veteran observed the 89th anniversary of the Civil War's end yesterday by asking for a special favor. William A. Lundy told a reporter who interviewed him at his home in Laurel Hill, Florida, to tell that young fellow in Washington, President Eisenhower, to have someone send me a Confederate flag. Soon as the word got out, the Chamber of Commerce in Biloxi, Mississippi, home of the Confederate President Jefferson Davis, announced there was no need to take it all the way to President Eisenhower. Secretary of the Chamber of Commerce Tony Ragson sending Lundy a rebel flag. U.S. Secretary of State John Foster Dulles flew to London yesterday, urgently seeking to win Britain to his Hurry Up United Action program designed to prevent communist domination of Indochina. Dulles told reporters the Western allies face a common danger in Indochina and added there was a need for him to talk with British leaders in great intimacy. He heard Foreign Secretary Anthony Eden standing at his shoulder say, "I am confident that the work that we shall have to do together will be of service not only to each other's country, but to the understanding and peace of the world." A youthful Chicago industrialist purchased almost the entire town of Lake Park, Florida yesterday, plus thousands of adjacent acres and miles of ocean frontage in a program aimed at attracting small wage earners to Florida. 37-year-old investor Ralph E. Stolken also bought several nearby islands, Lake Park about 5 miles north of Palm Beach, Florida. In Imperia, Italy, a curvaceous brunette elected Miss Spring by popular acclaim at a town party. While the crowd cheered, the winner stepped up to a microphone and boomed in a clear baritone, "Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, but I must confess..." Well, a 17-year-old student made his escape with the losers in hot pursuit, all the contestants in evening wear. A classified ad in the Oakland, California Tribune newspaper. "I'm responsible for all my debts and obligations of my wife, Virginia, both present and future, and am more than happy to be the provider for a woman who's borne me 5 lovely daughters and with an overabundance of love and care has made the past 8 years of married life the nicest years of my life. On this, our 8th anniversary, I wish to publicly express my gratitude, David Rousseau." Rousseau explained from his San Lorenzo, California home. He chose this way to celebrate his 8th anniversary just to show that there are some happily married couples in the world. One thing more, radio left blaring on the upper floor of a two-story motor lodge under construction in Salt Lake City. Idea to discourage prowlers? The radio no longer blares. Prowlers stole it. Some of the day's top news stories from the newspapers of Monday, April 12, 1954. A couple of notes on that. Of course, Indochina, to the youngsters who may not know, is what we now know as Vietnam. And the community of Lake Park, Florida, still remains around today. It is 9,000 people at the 2020 census. And according to the census population figures, the sixth highest percentage of Haitian residents in the U.S., 14% of the population are Haitian. The 19th highest percentage of Jamaican residents in the U.S., 5% of the population. Speakers of English as a first language, only 76% of residents. French Creole making up 13%, Spanish almost 6%, French 2 1/3%, Vietnamese 1.3%, and China about 0.5% of the population. That's some interesting information about Lake Park in Palm Beach County, Florida. The changing demographics of Florida. Alrighty, when Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox continues in a moment, we will head to Culver City, California, and an episode of Night Watch.
President Biden recently released a massive $6 trillion budget, the largest budget in U.S. history. And guess who pays the bill? That's right, you, the American taxpayer. American citizens and business owners will be paying more taxes. That's a fact. And if you owe back taxes, they will be coming after you to collect payments. In fact, President Biden also hired thousands more IRS agents to go after you. If you got a letter from the IRS and you know you owe back taxes or you haven't filed in years, don't put your head in the sand. Call us today. We've saved our customers millions of tax dollars. One quick, free phone call will show you how we can reduce your past tax bill and save you thousands. Guaranteed, or you pay nothing. Call now.
800-932-1431. 800-932-1431. That's 800-932-1431. Paid for by the Tax Helpline.
Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox continues with The Mean Streets of Culver City, California, an episode of Night Watch. This episode also broadcast on Monday, April 12, 1954, 70 years ago today.
Six to Control 1 reporting in service. Starting mileage 7833, 7833. Officers Perkins and Walters.
Roger, 5-6. 6:03 p.m. starting night watch.
This is Donn Reed. I'm a police recorder riding with this detective unit just reporting in service on the night watch. You're going to ride with us tonight.
5-6. Contact Lieutenant Lugo in car 50 at Washington and Overland. Regarding a 311.
5-6-10-4. We're in the area now.
A 311 is indecent exposure. I'll be on that case in just a few moments. But as I started to say, you're going to ride with us tonight and follow our investigations. And just remember one thing. The people you hear are not actors. This is it. This is real. This is what happens on the night watch.
Night Watch. The actual on-the-scene report of your police force in action. There are no actors, there is no script. Every voice, every sound is authentic. The investigations are recorded as they actually occur. Night Watch is presented with the cooperation of the Police Department of Culver City, California. W.N. Hildebrand, Chief. We switch you now to Car 5-6, already on investigation in the field, and your police recorder, Donn Reed.
We're approaching Washington and Overland Boulevard now, where we'll meet Lieutenant Lugo of the Uniform Division. Straight ahead, I can see his car parked in the gas station. Lights off, waiting for us. Here we are. Now, let's get over there and see what's up. The reason I wanted to see you is that I have a complaint here from a woman. This particular man exposed himself
to her, and I have the license number here. I've run the DMV on it, and this is the name and address of the person. I'm sure she can identify him. And I wonder if you and Walter will follow this thing up and go pick the man up.
Okay, right. You got the address, sir?
Yes, it's right on this piece of paper here.
Okay, fine. We'll go right out there.
Swell.
You heard the lieutenant assign us to this exposure case. In plain English, this means we're going to pick up a suspect who evidently has exposed himself indecently in front of a woman victim on a public street. So, let's get back to our car and get underway. We've been driving for better than an hour, and as the suspect in this case lives in another city some 30 miles away. A moment ago, we stopped at a local police station and picked up another one of their officers to go in with us. This is customary courtesy when you're working out of your district. It's just a matter of blocks now, but before we do, I want to lean over the front seat here for just a moment. Sergeant, I noticed that when the lieutenant assigned us to this case, he seemed a little more concerned than usual. Any particular reason?
Well, yes, Don. I think what he had in mind was that in this type of a case where you've got a man exposing himself to either women or children, you've got a man that is usually mentally ill.
Mm-hmm.
And this coupled with the fact that many serious crimes, including even murder, will start with this kind of a background. Mm-hmm. Now, it doesn't have to be premeditated, but quite often the victim will scream or will fight. And as a result, the suspect, in his panic, he may injure the victim or do her great bodily harm. And even in some cases, as I said, the results will be homicide.
Oh, I see. Well, that's why Lieutenant Lugo is so anxious that we pick up this person.
That's it. Let's see. This should be about the house along here. Wait a minute. That looks like the car out there. Yeah. This is it here.
Mm-hmm. This is it.
Kurt, I'm going to cover the back door. Do you want to open the front with the lieutenant?
Yeah.
Approaching the house now. Young lady coming up to meet us at the door. The suspect is stretched out on a divan, listening to the radio. Young fellow, nice looking. In the corner, a couple of young girls playing with dolls. The police lieutenant from this local city right here is identifying us.
Come in.
Here's my identification. The gentleman from Culver City?
Is that your car out in front?
Yeah.
I'd like to take you along back to Culver City for some questions with regard to crime that occurred in Culver City.
Do you suppose I'll be able to go to work tonight?
You won't make it tonight.
Isn't that funny, Sergeant? He's not even curious why we're picking him up.
He knows why we're here.
Yeah, but if I were being arrested, I'd at least ask why.
That's an important piece of evidence. He knows he's committed a crime, so he's not even going to ask why.
Mm. Is the young lady here his wife?
No, I was just talking to her. That's his sister-in-law.
Hmm.
Seems his wife works. We'll talk to her later.
Oh. What about the two youngsters over here? They belong to him?
Yeah, he's the father of two children.
You know, somehow he doesn't fit the crime. Nice looking, well dressed. Could be the young fellow that lives next door.
Here he is. You ready to go, fella?
Why are you calling me, Daddy?
Well, I'll try to be back. Go go see Mommy.
Mommy?
I'll see you.
Be right back.
Well, we have the suspect in custody and heading back now for our car. We'll ride up in front with Sergeant Perkins. Detective Walter will sit in the back with the prisoner.
Thanks. Appreciate very much for your cooperation, your department's cooperation.
I'll give you guys a ring on that deal. I'm very glad to have met you, sir.
My pleasure. Thank you, Lieutenant.
If we can help any time, let us know.
Okay.
Good night, sir. Good night.
She is in Culver City in the last couple of days.
She knows my wife works over there. Pick her up.
What time do you pick your wife up?
Well,
you pick up.
No, I don't.
You have no idea at all?
No, sir.
Why don't you think a little bit about what's happened and start giving us the truth? You know why we're down here just as well as we do. We wouldn't come down and pick you out of 3 million people in the county of Los Angeles if we didn't know what we were doing.
Yeah.
You know that. So why don't you tell us?
Well, I can well imagine. There's only one thing that I could possibly imagine what it would be, and I can't imagine it could be that.
What is it that you imagine?
Well, why don't you tell me, and then if you're right, I'll tell you.
Well, you know why we're down here. Why don't you tell us? We've heard this story before from others, too.
Well, I haven't committed any crime that I know of. I hate to...
What have you done?
Well, I'm kind of embarrassed about the whole thing.
Doesn't embarrass us any. We've talked to people before on the same subject.
Well, a girl on the street corner saw me last night when I was... Do I have to say it?
I have to say it. You tell us. What were you doing?
Sounds kind of silly when you say it.
Did you expose yourself to her?
Well, I didn't expose myself to her. I think she saw me.
What were you doing?
But I didn't intend for her to see me because I didn't see her standing there until I turned around, and as she was standing there, I guess she was waiting for a bus or something, and so I turned right away as soon as I saw that she was standing there.
You mean you had your private parts exposed?
Yes.
When the girl was standing alongside the car?
Well, I suppose she was. Either she walked up or she was standing there. I didn't notice her.
Did you try to attract her attention to you?
No, I didn't. I went around the block and I came back by to see if she, you know, was looking and trying to see whether she had noticed or not, but...
Have you ever exposed yourself in the car just to yourself?
Possibly.
Well, do you do it when you're driving, too?
I suppose maybe I have at one time or another, but I mean,
Do you feel this urge to just stop and park all by yourself?
Well, occasionally, yes, I might say so. I kind of have my own views about that, and I feel I want relief. Well, that's the easiest way I know to get it. We all do stupid and silly things sometimes, and each one has their own faults.
When you get this urge, do you ever stop to consider the surroundings or the area in which you're in, or anybody being able to see you?
Well,
or is the urge?
I might say, naturally, I mean, to a certain extent, I don't make any bones about heading off someplace to try to get to some particular spot or so on to do it. I always try to be very careful about having no one see me. Naturally, I mean, you don't want anybody to see you doing anything like that. But I certainly never thought that I would ever be picked up for doing anything like that.
Against the law.
It's against the law if nobody sees you.
In case somebody saw you.
Well, I know, but I mean...
That's why we're down here, to pick you up.
Naturally, I understand that.
We wonder how many cases have happened in the past in various localities that the police were not fortunate to obtain a license number or a description of the car, where there are outstanding crimes have been committed. 5-6, in with one. We open the booking door.
10-4-5-6.
You are listening to Night Watch and following the activities of a detective unit on their tour of duty. The people you hear are not actors, and every voice and every sound is real. The investigations are recorded as they actually occur. We will give you the final results of tonight's case at the conclusion of The Night Watch. Now we switch you back to police headquarters and police recorder Donn Reed.
We've been here at headquarters for over an hour. The prisoner has been booked and placed in a cell. The suspect's wife has been called to the station, and Sergeant Perkins and Detective Walter are in the office now discussing the case with her. Let's go on in. She's sitting at the desk.
Well, I mean, is anybody
small in stature, early 20s, modestly dressed, attractive, sort of a bewildered expression on her face.
He does park the car, and then he goes with these fellows that he shares a ride with.
Where did this occur?
What?
Where did this occur?
Here in Culver City.
I mean, he's not even in this vicinity.
Doesn't he ever come up in this area?
Well, no.
He doesn't?
I mean, unless he comes after me.
I see.
And then I'm never at work that late.
Uh-huh.
This
what
is
time,
a,
what time
the
is
reason
he?
We're late tonight is because I was trying to get information on him tonight.
Mm-hmm. And what time did he pick you up last night about?
It was about 6:30.
Did you notice anything unusual about him last night?
No.
Was he at all nervous or anything?
No.
Well, he was involved in an incident last night prior to the time that he picked you up.
I just can't imagine that.
But how long have you been married?
4 years.
4 years. Have children?
Yes, I have two, and I'm expecting another one.
May I ask you a personal question?
Certainly.
How do you and your husband get along?
Perfect.
No disharmony or trouble?
No, we've always gotten along perfect. Were these children or grown-ups or what?
Well, these were adults.
Well, I'm just shocked. I mean, we have two children. I guess you saw them when you picked them up. My sister said they were crying. But, I haven't noticed anything different about him. I mean, he's always the same. He's very attentive to the children and myself. I mean, and he's been a good husband, as you know, and a father. I've never deprived him of anything, and I can't imagine anything like this. When could I see him or talk to him?
Well, it'd be better if you wait until Monday before you see him. So if you feel that you want to get a lawyer?
I can't afford one.
Well, I don't think you absolutely need one until we finish the investigation, and then you can see where you stand.
Mm-hmm.
And if you feel that you need a lawyer, you can hire yourself one. Or if necessary, you can continue to serve as a public defender.
So he'll be held here?
He'll be held here, and if you want to contact the department Monday, I will have more information regarding it. Okay, if you'll come along with me, ma'am. Good night.
Yes, thank you.
Is Lieutenant Lugo in his office?
No, I have him over here, please.
No. Okay, wait a minute. Here he is now. Never mind.
Lieutenant Walter and I have been talking to this fellow, and he admits the accusations in the case. He appears to be a fairly intelligent man and normal in all appearance, but talking to him, well, you can tell he's got quite a psychiatric problem there, that something should be done on it. Now, we're just about ready to make out the reports on him and wanted to talk to you to see what you recommend in it.
Well, Perk, you've checked into his background, and if he has a problem, I would suggest that you mention that in your reports to the district attorney. And possibly it may lead to giving him some help in his particular case.
Well, he is perfectly willing to get the help. He wants the help. He has no prior criminal record, but talking to him in his background, well, you can see he has this problem that has existed for some time.
Excuse me, Lieutenant, while you're making out these reports, I'd like to go over for a moment and talk with the prisoner about some of the points you've discussed here just now. Sorry with you.
Surely, go right ahead.
Fine, thanks.
One thing on the report before I get out.
That all your statements have been recorded for police testimony as well as for the radio program Night Watch. And I'd like to have your permission to use this entire case for broadcast purposes, if that's all right with you.
Okay.
Now that you're alone here in the cell, I'd like to know how you really feel about this thing. Now, I don't want to discuss the possibility of mental illness or that you're a family man, wife, children. However, I noticed in the car you stated that you felt that you had not committed a crime. I think now that you realize that you have. But somewhere, possibly, there are other people suffering from this same compulsion. So if you had You had a chance to speak of your experience. What would you say to them? What would you tell them?
All I have to say is that if there's anyone, if this happens to strike anyone that might be listening to it, just if you can take anybody's word for it, take mine. That it isn't any of it worth. It just isn't worthwhile. No matter what the crime may be today in that line, and no matter what satisfaction a person might get out of it, it certainly isn't worth. It isn't worth an ounce of what you have to go through if you should ever get caught. Now, I want to say this much: that I've been treated pretty nice by all the officers since I've been here. But boy, when I come into your house and you wait and go to work, and they tell you, "Come on, let's go," don't even take a belt with you because they'll take it away. That right there is enough proof that it isn't worthwhile.
Okay. Good night.
You have been listening to Actual Investigations as recorded from Detective Unit 5-6 on The Night Watch. And now back to Police Headquarters and Chief W.N. Hildebrand.
Tonight's case involving the indecent exposure brings to mind that these suspects remain at large for long periods because the victims either feel embarrassment and fail to report the incident or provide the police with little or no description. In that event, your law enforcement officers are powerless to apprehend them. We must depend on the citizen and their cooperation to control this problem. In the case heard tonight, it was apparent the suspect was in need of mental treatment. This fact was included in the officer's report, and the court directed the prisoner be given treatment as part of his sentence. Consequently, when this man is released, he'll be ready to take his place in normal society. It is my honest opinion that the average citizen does not realize the real problems facing the law enforcement officer today or the dangers they encounter to maintain public security. That's why we are bringing you the facts as they actually happen. If we succeed in bringing this message to just a few, then our efforts will be well rewarded in presenting Night Watch.
Thank you, Chief Hildebrand. You have just heard on-the-scene reports of your police force in action. Every voice, every sound has been real. Night Watch, brought to you through the cooperation of your police department of Culver City, California, is produced by Sterling Tracy and Jim Headlock, with technical advice by Sergeant Ron Perkins, and described in the field by police recorder Donn Reed.
And that wraps up our excursion to the date April 12, 1954, a Monday, with that episode of Night Watch. And you're listening to Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. Up next, we'll go to a year earlier, April 12, 1953, and an episode of Escape.
Daily, the broadcasts of Radio Free Europe and Radio Free Asia strike through the Iron Curtain, bringing the truth about the free world to the captive peoples behind it. Help send a message by giving to the 1952 Crusade for Freedom.
And we continue on this Friday edition of Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. We'll start off our Saturday with some westerns and some more crime. We will go to 1958 for episodes of Luke Slaughter of Tombstone and Frontier Gentlemen, and then to 1954 again for episodes of Dragnet and Crime and Peter Chambers, and we'll top it all off with another episode of Claudia. By the way, Superman will return with an episode on Sunday. But right now, let us get to another episode. This episode of Radio's Outstanding Theater of Thrills stars Chester. Well, not really. Parley Baer, who played Chester, in an episode of Escape, 71 years ago, April 12, 1953, a spy drama. And this is called Classified Secret.
Tired of the everyday grind? Ever dream of a life of romantic adventure? Want to get away from it all? We offer you
escape. Escape, designed to free you from the four walls of today for a half hour of high adventure. You are traveling east on a cross-country bus, while among your fellow passengers, seemingly innocent and friendly, are a man and a woman who plan to destroy you and 150 million of your countrymen. Listen now as Escape brings you Anthony Ellis's exciting story, Classified Secret.
Nice day.
Yes.
Kid's sure not spring. Look at him.
I've been watching them.
Yeah. Kind of glad, though, I haven't got any.
Oh?
Well, you know, world conditions, things the way they are. Who wants to bring a kid into it?
I suppose so. Do you have a match?
Sure. Here you are.
Thanks. Have you got it? What's the matter?
Well, you don't look the type. I almost hoped you weren't.
Have you got it?
With me? No, but I'll take you to where it is.
All right. The money's in tens, twenties, and fifties.
In the sack with the groceries?
Mm-hmm. I thought it'd be safer that way.
I guess so. How much?
10,000.
Ten?
That's what you agreed to?
Uh-uh. I said 20.
I was told 10.
They made a mistake then, didn't they? Sorry.
What are you trying to do?
Nothing. Not a thing.
I was told you were with us.
I am, but I get paid for it too, don't you?
I can't sit here any longer. We might be watched. Will you please give me...
Sorry. It was a misunderstanding.
But...
Unless you want to take me to the head man, maybe he can straighten it out.
I haven't any instructions for that. Where can I reach you?
As of about 2 hours, and now you can't. I'm leaving town.
Will you give us 24 hours? It'll take that long.
I'm sorry. If you can't pay what I want, there's somebody else who will.
I'm going.
So long. I was sitting on a bench in a little park in North Hollywood, California. The early spring sun was warm and there was a smell of fresh-cut grass. I watched the woman I'd never seen before walk off down the path. She was headed for the avenue and some cars parked beyond the trees. I thought how nice it would have been if she were just a woman in the park and nothing else. I waited until she was out of sight. Then I got up and walked away in the opposite direction. I got the bus at the Hollywood station. I had a train ticket in my pocket, but with the new development, it looked safer to ride the bus. Just before we pulled out, a girl climbed aboard and came down the aisle looking for a seat.
Excuse me, is this number...
18.
Oh,
Thank you.
Oh, here, let me put your case up.
Thank you. I was afraid I was going to miss it.
Yeah, I know how it is. I settled back and watched the city drift away into desert country. As the buses go, it was pretty quiet. There was a 4 or 5 year old kid with his mother a couple of seats forward, but he dozed off almost as soon as he got running. I took a look at the girl sitting next to me, not in the way you might think, but because in my business, you get to learn to look at people. You never know who it might be. She must have felt me watching. She lowered the magazine she was reading.
Would you care to look at one of these?
That's nice of you. I always forget to buy them.
Well, this one's a mystery. I don't usually read them, but on a long trip, they kind of pass the time away.
Yeah, they do. How far are you going?
New York.
That's a long trip, all right.
I'll say. I haven't been back for 10 years. Bet it's changed.
Yeah, I guess so. I read the mystery well into Arizona. When I finished, it was beginning to get dark. The kid up ahead was awake and hungry. There was a feeling of expectation on the bus as we drove into the first night of travel.
Did you enjoy it?
Hmm? Oh, yes, it was fine. Thanks a lot.
What was it about?
Spies. Real exciting.
I like spy movies sometimes. I think they do so many of them. You read about it in the papers all the time. I don't know. I think people would get sick of it.
Yeah, I guess you're right.
They're exciting, like you say. I bet it isn't really like that.
I doubt it. Say, my name's Charlie. Oh, sure. Charlie Rader.
Oh, how do you do? I'm Julie Spaulding.
Hi.
That kid sounds as hungry as I am.
Yeah, we ought to be stopping soon.
Yeah, I hope so.
About 15 minutes later, we pulled up at a restaurant terminal and went in for food. I watched for any new passengers who might be getting on. I didn't see anybody, and as soon as I'd finished my sandwich and coffee, I sent a telegram to New York and then got back on the bus. The girl, Julie, and I seemed to be hitting it off, and it was pleasant enough to pass the time. After we got rolling, the kid up ahead decided to sing himself to sleep. It was like a crooning over and over again, the same song, the same few notes. I guess it put everybody else to sleep except him.
Makes you sleepy, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Reminds me of when I was a kid. I used to do that. Kids are funny.
How?
Well, I don't know. I'm going back to New York for my sister's wedding. She's getting married next week. She says she wants lots of kids. I don't know.
Yeah, I know what you mean.
Mind if I ask you something?
No, I don't mind. What?
Are you married?
No.
I don't mean it the way it sounds. I'm always interested in trying to guess about people. Now, I would have figured you were a married man with maybe 2 or 3 kids.
No, I'm not married.
Oh. I hope you don't think I'm nosy.
No.
Well, that kid singing fixed me. I'm gonna take a nap. Good night, Charlie.
Good night. I must have dropped off too. When I woke up, she had her head on my shoulder. A lock of her hair was falling over her closed eyes. And then I knew something was different on the bus. Somebody on the other side of the aisle, watching.
Excuse me, mister. Have you got a match? I'm clean out.
Sure. Just a minute. Here you are.
Thanks.
No, keep them.
Oh, fine. Thanks a lot.
Say, have you got any idea where we are?
I'm not sure. I got on at Flagstaff an hour or so back. Oh, boy, I envy her. I wish I could sleep like that. Your wife?
No.
Oh, say, that's rude. Taking your matches and not offering you a cigarette.
Oh, that's okay. No, I don't want one now, thanks.
Say, I want to tell you something. There's a lady in the seat behind you. I think you've met her before in the park. Right? We brought her with us to identify you. But she gave us a pretty good description back in L.A.
Good for her.
Well, this is going to be a nice trip. Nothing like traveling with people you know, is there?
Nothing like it.
I don't suppose you've got any reading material you would let me look at.
How about a mystery? It's a spy story. Pretty good.
No, I was thinking of something else. I think you know. Something more scientific. I'm very interested in airplanes. Jet motors.
Sorry. He looked across at me, smiling, pleasant. And to anybody watching, it was nothing more than the casual conversation of two strangers brought together by the night and sympathy of loneliness. Then he leaned back and, reaching inside his jacket, brought out a small automatic, which he kept very carefully hidden from any eyes but mine.
Always carry this with me on a trip. You never know.
I knew, all right. If they couldn't buy what they wanted, there were other ways. That's what he was telling me. And I saw in the man's smiling face that I'd never reach New York unless I killed them before they killed me.
We will return to Escape in just a moment, but first, the program that follows tonight's story of Escape is a special repeat broadcast of CBS Radio's hard-hitting drama, Bomb Target USA. With Arthur Godfrey as narrator and a corps of crack CBS radio newsmen reporting from spotter locations and from so-called enemy bombing squadrons approaching our shores, Bomb Target USA reports factually and without fanfare exactly what America can expect today if enemy atomic bombers raided our major cities. Immediately following Escape tonight, on most of these same CBS radio stations, keep tuned for Bomb Target USA. And now, back to Escape.
Julie and I had breakfast somewhere in New Mexico. The woman from the park and the man who carried the small automatic sat in a booth while we ate at the counter. I'd thought about things most of the night, and I decided to tell the girl. Not too much, but enough so that she might be able to help. And I knew I'd need some help.
Coffee's pretty good here.
Yeah. Cigarette?
No, thanks.
Julie?
Yes?
I want to tell you something.
Oh?
I don't want you to turn around and look. Just pretend we're talking about the weather, coffee, or anything, but listen.
Well, sure, Charlie.
There's a couple sitting in the booth behind us. They're spies.
Hmm? Oh, you...
I'm not kidding. I can't tell you much, but as you love your life, you'll believe me.
You're kidding. Spy?
Don't turn around. Smile. Just listen.
But I...
They're trying to get hold of the plans for a new jet motor. It's faster than anything anybody else has got.
You are kidding.
No, I'm not.
How do you know? How do you know about it?
I'm working for the government.
FBI?
In a way. Now, I need you to help me.
Me?
They think I've got the blueprints, the plans, and they're going to try and get them from me.
But can't we get the police?
No.
Well, why?
Because we're trying to get the head man. And if those two are arrested, we'll have to start all over again. They think I'm working with them. But I got tough about the money they offered, so now they're going to try and get rid of me and get the secret for nothing.
Did they follow you from Los Angeles?
Yes, they got on during the night in Flagstaff.
All right, folks.
I don't
let's
see.
Go.
Well,
just stick with me. I'll explain at the next stop. We can't talk about it on the bus because she's sitting right behind and he's across the aisle.
Listen, are you pulling my... No. No, you're not, are you?
I'm not. We went on through New Mexico and the Pink Rock and the desert. We talked a lot of nonsense, and after a while I could see she was getting back to the idea that I'd been kidding, especially after the man with the gun introduced himself as Mr. Hutchinson and started to talk about fishing. It was about a half hour before our lunch stop.
Now you take some of that Northern California country. Talk about trout. Steelhead. I tell you,
my
you have never
used to
seen...
My dad take us up, my sister and me.
Oh.
Take us up to a place in Maine.
Oh.
Dad always wanted a couple of boys, I guess, but when he saw what he got, he figured it wouldn't spoil his plans anyway. So we took us fishing every summer. You should have seen the fishing up there.
Yeah. I'd like to, someday. I'd like that. How about you, Mr. Rader? Do you like fishing?
No, not much.
Did you ever try it?
A little, when I was a kid.
You ought to take it up again, if you have time.
Yes, I might do that.
If a man had a little money put away, he could do a lot of fishing. That's the way to live. Have about $10,000, go all over the country fishing, no work, no worries. How does that sound, Miss Spaulding?
Oh, what a life.
It'd take more than $10,000.
No, I don't know. Ten's better than nothing.
$10,000? Why...
They went on talking, and I did some thinking. He was smarter than I'd thought. Looked like a nice, average guy and behaved like one. That's one thing I'd learned. The more ordinary you can be, the less you're going to be suspected, and these people had it down to a science. It wasn't going to be easy because I was going to have to convince Julie all over again. I could see that. My chance didn't come until that evening after our dinner stop. By that time, the woman in the park, who went by the name of Lisa Nyland, Hutchinson, the girl, and myself, all four of us were buddies. We'd pulled up over the Colorado border. There was some kind of trouble up ahead, a slide or a wreck. The driver told us we'd have a half hour or so before we went on.
You want to take a walk for a while? There's a cafe a couple of hundred yards back. I'll give you a call when we're ready to move on.
Yeah. Oh, kind of nice to have an extra leg stretch. How about some coffee?
That'd be nice.
Charlie?
Oh, I don't know. I'd like to have a look at the valley down there. We might walk up the dirt road away, get a pretty good view, sunset and all.
Romantic, huh?
Sure. Why not?
Oh, Charlie.
Okay with you, Lisa? You feel romantic? Want to see a valley in the sunset?
That'd be very nice.
Okay, let's go.
We walked away from the bus and up a narrow ranch road. About 100 yards up, there was a curve and around to the stand of trees. When we got there, you couldn't hear the sounds from the highway any longer. It was peaceful and it was very pretty. I knew that Hutchinson was delighted about the suggestion. It was going to give him his chance, but he made the mistake of playing it a little too clever. And he kept his game of small talk going a minute too long. We'd got to the top of a cliff overlooking the valley when I stumbled on a rock and fell a few steps behind before they had a chance to stop. And when they did, I already had my gun out.
Hey, what are you going to do? Target practice?
No. Julie, get over here. You two, stay where you are and keep your hands behind your head.
Charlie, are you sure? They seem to...
I know what they seem. Now look, I don't want to do this, but it's you or me. You should have made the right deal in the first place. I can't let you go, you know that.
We might still make a deal.
You had your chance.
We've got the 10,000. How about waiting till we get to the next town? We'll have the rest of it telegraphed.
I make mistakes, but not that kind.
If you told us what you wanted, we might have been able to get the 20,000 for you in Los Angeles.
Turn around, both of you.
Now, wait a minute. We're all in this together. We all want the same thing. You figure you can get more money from the head man in the East. Okay. Give us a chance to get it for you. We're in contact.
Turn around.
He gives us our orders. What difference does it make? Now, look, you shoot us. What do you think they'll do? They won't let you get away with it. They'll kill you.
Charlie, you can't just shoot them. Turn them over to the police. You can't
be
just
quiet.
Shoot them.
He can't tell the police, Julie. He's with us. Only he wants money out of it. And he thinks he'll get more from the head man in the East.
Turn around. I'm not going to say it again.
Charlie, don't. I know you've got a duty, but you can arrest them. Please, you can still...
I told you to be quiet.
Arrest? Listen, Rader. You're not going to... You're not going to kill us over 10,000. Why, it's murder, even if you...
Miss Nyland dropped without a sound. Hutchinson held his middle for a second and tried to keep his balance. I shot him in the back of the head. I knew he was dead before his body slipped to the ground. The girl just stood next to me, her hands tightly covering her mouth, and she was shivering. I took a look across the wide valley. The sky was turning purple.
I've never seen anybody killed before.
I'm sorry.
Couldn't you have arrested them or something? Couldn't you? Did you have to?
I had to. They wouldn't have stopped at killing both of us if they'd had the chance.
What are you going to do? What are you going to do now?
I've got to get the money for evidence.
What are you going to tell the driver? He'll ask where they are. Charlie? Driver's going to wonder where they are. Charlie, what are you doing?
I've got to put them over the cliff.
Oh, no. Oh, no.
I've got to.
Oh. Oh, no. No, you can't. Charlie, no.
All right. Come on. We got back to the bus, and neither of us said anything about the two we'd walked off with. I guess nobody had seen us together, and after waiting around for another half hour, the driver gave up.
Well, I'll drop their baggage in La Junta. Better notify the police, too.
Screw you, all right.
Okay, folks. Sorry for the delay. You better go back to your seat, mister.
Sure. I was starved when we pulled into the depot at La Junta. I'd already made up my mind to lay over and take a detour on another bus. The girl wasn't going to be able to keep quiet much longer, and I had to get rid of her. We got out of the bus, and the two men were standing alongside, waiting.
Just a minute, please. We're special agents for the FBI. Search him, Larry.
Okay. Yeah. Just a gun and money.
Where are the other two?
The other two?
They're dead. He killed them.
Oh. We'll take those plans now, Mr. Rader. And don't do anything silly. There are four men covering you.
Okay. It's in my shoe. You want me to take it off now?
Please.
Here.
Thank you, Mr. Reeder. This isn't worth anything, really, you know. We planted it in the factory in L.A. for someone to steal. What we wanted was to be led to the top man in New York. And when you sent that wire to him back in Arizona, we got him.
Oh.
We were worried about you, Julie, when you didn't call us from Albuquerque.
I didn't get a chance. He was with me all the time.
Is she? Is she? Are you playing spy too, Julie?
I'm working for the government, Mr. Rader.
She's been following you since you stole the plans.
Well, you fooled me. I bet you fooled Hutchinson and Nyland, too. It won't matter to them, though, will it? Well, that's the way it goes.
Take him away, will you? I had to watch him murder those two. I don't want to hear him laugh about it.
Come on, Rader. We've got a car waiting.
Sure. So long, Julie. Nice to have met you.
Escape has brought you Classified Secret, written and directed by Anthony Ellis, starring Parley Baer. Featured in the cast were Charlotte Lawrence, Peter Leeds, Miriam Crucian, Tim Graham, Leroy Leonard, and Georgia Ellis. The special music for Escape is composed and conducted by Leith Stevens. Next week.
You are in a cantina in Mexico, listening to a man speak his hate for you in word and music, while somewhere in jeopardy without your knowledge and beyond your reach is the one you love, who may lose her life for the man who sits across the table hating you is the only one who can save her.
So listen next week when Escape brings you E. Jack Newman's exciting story, El Guitarrero. Tomorrow night, the Lux Radio Theater stars Jane Wyman and Dick Hames. The play is Just For You, with Jane recreating her original screen role. It's a musical comedy about a widowed Broadway play producer who loves his star and faces complications in the reactions of his son and daughter. Just For You, Lux Radio Theater presents the stellar co-starring combination Jane Wyman and Dick Hames tomorrow night on most of these same CBS radio stations. The same evening, CBS Radio stars Fred McMurray in Suspense's saga of The Great Train Robbery. That's tomorrow night at the Star's address. This is Roy Rowan speaking. And remember, you have a date with Arthur Godfrey's Talent Scouts, Monday evenings on the CBS Radio Network.
Years ago, April 12, 1953, Escape, here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. Visit our webpage, classicradio.stream, classicradio.stream. Stream our shows. If you'd like to help us out by buying me a copy, you can do that. There's also a couple of things there that you can purchase to help us achieve our mission here and continue our mission here. Right now, we will have an episode of Sky King. That's coming up next here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox.
Americans have always been noted for their know-how, and you young men in search of a career You can put this practical talent to excellent use in one of our nation's many engineering schools. At the present time, we need engineers. We need them to maintain our scientific and engineering superiority. So look to your future, to America's future. Plan now to become an engineer.
From the people who created Captain Midnight came Sky King. Several actors played the part of the Sky King, including Earl Nightingale, John Reed King, and Roy Engel. Pat Bibbins played Clipper. Burl Vaughn portrayed Penny. In this episode of Sky King, from 73 years ago, April 12, 1951, 73 years ago, this episode is entitled The Lady Sheriff.
Hi, gang! This is Peter Pan! Every day when school's out, reach up on the shelves, grab that jar of Peter Pan, and treat yourself.
Peter Pan Peanut Butter presents Sky King. Today, the Lady Sheriff. In the early morning darkness, the Flying Crown Ranch is surrounded by headlights from cars and jeeps. Overhead, a plane cruises slowly, flashing a searchlight back and forth over the bleak prairie. And a strange rider brings her mount to a halt in the foothills, overlooking the ranch house.
Whoa, Indian boy, whoa.
A strange rider, indeed, an elderly woman. Astride a ridden-out palomino, dressed in elaborate Western clothes, and in her belt, two pearl-handled six-shooters, studded with diamonds. She scans the countryside, smiles, then wheels the weary mount down toward the ranch house when suddenly several riders come out of the darkness.
There she is!
But swift as lightning, the majestic old lady's hands reach for the diamond-studded six-shooters and...
Look out! Take cover! Spray and land!
Get up, Indian boy! Get up!
She got away. Hit two of her men, Trent.
They're all right. She won't go far. Come on, she's heading for King's ranch house. Right. We got it surrounded. Let's start riding! Come on!
Hey, Sky.
Were you making all that noise, Sheriff?
Have you seen a rider around here tonight?
No. Been asleep, Sheriff. This racket woke us up.
Our men are searching the stables and barns, Sheriff. Huh? Had her trapped in the hills back there, but she shot her way out.
She shot her way out?
Winged two of my best men.
Sky, this is going to be hard to believe, but it's Lady Alice we're hunting.
Lady Alice? But, Sheriff, there must be some mistake.
That's what I thought, too, Sky. But there's a statewide alarm to be on the lookout for the lady.
You bet there is. She's run out with $60,000 worth of diamonds. My diamonds, and I aim to get them back.
Who is Lady Alice?
A walking legend, honey.
Yeah, she's one of Arizona's earliest settlers. She's been sheriff of Flint Ridge County for half a century.
Yeah, she's a corking good sheriff, too.
We could have trapped anyone else with roadblocks, but not Lady Alice and that palomino of hers.
Oh, I can't believe it. The law hunting down Lady Alice, why, she's as honest
as... I'll tell you how honest she is, King.
And who are you?
Name's Trent. I staked out a diamond claim and went to Flint Ridge County to get stockholders to put up money to mine the claim. To show my good faith, I gave my diamond samples to Lady Alice's security. And look what happened.
The lady always was crazy about diamonds, Sky. Those diamond-studded revolvers and...
Maybe, but she wouldn't steal diamonds, Sheriff.
She must have an accomplice somewhere, Sheriff. Couldn't hope to get away with this alone. And she was heading for the Flying Crown.
Look here, Trent. I don't know why she was heading here, but I do know Sky King, the most honest man alive.
Hey, and sir, if you come here, quick!
Well, they found something in the stable.
Something or someone. Come on.
Should string her up for this.
Sky, if Lady Alice is mad, I want cover. She shoots straighter than a porcupine quill.
Here we are. Right in here.
Well, I'll be.
Two men.
And they're tied and gagged.
Sheriff, these are my men. Whoa, do something. Don't just stand there.
Easy, Trent. Help me to ungag these men.
Yeah, I'll give you a hand, Sheriff.
Stole this from back. Beyond that stall where the guns are.
You fool. Get out there and signal my plane to land.
Okay, boss.
Sheriff, She's got a fortune in my diamonds, and she's getting away.
It's almost daylight, Sheriff. The lady can't go far on a horse. And between Tramp's plane and the Songbird, we should be able to stop her.
Good idea, Sky.
Penny,
yeah?
Go warm up the Songbird.
Yeah, sure.
I'm starting after her on my plane right now.
I won't believe this until Lady Alice tells me herself, Sheriff.
I know, but...
Scott!
Huh?
Scott, come look at this store.
What is it, Clipper?
Look, Sky. A Palomino. And it isn't one of ours.
No, it isn't, and it's been ridden hard.
That proves it, Sky. That proves it. I'd recognize Lady Alice's Palomino anywhere.
Hey, what's Penny doing to the Songbird?
Why, she's going to take off.
Look out.
Gracious sakes. Taking off in the dark like that. Almost took the stable with her.
Sky, someone was with Penny. I couldn't see the face, but the hair was snow white.
Lady Alice.
Sheriff, you and your men stay in contact with me by radio.
Check.
Jim Clipper and I'll follow the Songbird in the Flying Arrow. We'll use radar till daylight. Come on. We'll find out where Lady Alice is making Penny fly her.
Songbird calling the Flying Arrow. Songbird calling the Flying Arrow.
It's Penny on the radio.
Here, I'll get it. Come in, Songbird. This is the Flying Arrow. Over.
I'll take it, Penny. Hello, Sky.
Hey, it's Lady Alice, Sky.
This is Sky King, Lady Alice. What's wrong?
That mine on Rocky Bluff? Well, Penny and I are going down there. Got any guns on that flying machine of yours besides your six shooters?
We have a 20-millimeter cannon in the nose.
Good. Keep us covered. That's all.
Hello. Lady Alice. Come in, Songbird.
What's wrong, Sky?
Oh, they cut me out.
Sky, that mine on Rocky Bluff hasn't been worked in years.
Well, I'll be a two-toed lizard. Look. Men are working down there. Looks like a beehive.
Hey. And he's landing on the flat cliff just below the bluff. Hey, they must be going the rest of the way by foot.
Circle over again, will you, Clipper? There's something strange about that mining camp.
Sky, Trent's plane is closing in on us. Huh? Funny he hasn't contacted us by radio.
Hey, Sky, ain't he coming a mite too close?
Woo, Jim's right. What's the matter with them?
Maybe the radio's out of commission. Looks like they're trying to give us some kind of a signal.
Yeah, look. There's Trent waving his arms from the controls.
Keep her steady, Clipper, till I can make out what he wants.
Hey, Sky, Trent's man is opening the cabin door.
He's got a machine gun.
I'll take the controls, Clipper.
Sky, we're hit. We're going to crash.
Bring her out of this dive, Sky.
I don't want to, Clipper. We have to land fast.
Real fast. Sky, we're on fire.
Hence, overlook the fact that a jet plane can crash land a lot easier than a piston-driven plane. Keep our landing gear up, we'll level off and slide in on our belly. No propeller nose us over.
Sky, we can't level off in time.
Oh, but we have to.
Hang on. As soon as we hit, grab that fire extinguisher, Clipper. Get out and spray the plane.
Oh, after all these years in the saddle, this is how I'm going to be through, dude.
Fire's out. But the Flying Arrow sure is going to need some repairs before she flies again.
Oh, we're lucky that we don't need repairs, Cliff.
Oh, the greatest landing ever, Sky. Mm-hmm. It was almost a crash instead of a crash landing.
Trent obviously heard us talking to Lady Alice over the radio, and he doesn't want us covering her. Let's get up Rocky Bluff in a hurry. Penny and Lady Alice are in for trouble.
Trouble? With all those people we saw working up there?
Jim.
Huh?
I know now what was so strange about those figures we saw from the air.
What's that, Sky?
They weren't moving. Not one of them ever moved.
What?
You mean they all...
Blocks of wood that look like men from overhead. Come on. Our feet are the only means of transportation we've got. Let's start using them.
Yep. Hey!
Stay behind these rocks, quick.
Sky, what in tarnation is going on around here?
Trent's landed on the same cliff as the Songbird. He's cut us off from reaching Penny and Lady Alice.
But why, Sky? What's so mysterious about this old diamond mine up on Rocky Bluff that he's trying to kill us?
I don't know, Penny. We've got to help Penny and Lady Alice. And there's only one way to get to Rocky Bluff now. And that's to go up there shooting.
Say, fellas and gals, when you've been in school or out playing all day, I'll bet that you get home about as hungry as a starving giant, don't you? Now, I don't know what giants do when they get hungry, but here's the smartest thing that you can do. First of all, make tracks for that Peter Pan jar and fix yourself a whopping thick, wonderful-tasting peanut butter sandwich. Just slap it on extra thick. You know, Peter Pan is made of specially selected fresh roasted peanuts that are just bursting with extra good flavor. They're ground up extra smooth and packed right away before any of that wonderful fresh roasted peanut flavor can escape. And then, Peter Pan's special vacuum-sealed jar top locks that flavor in for sure. Oh, man. That's why Peter Pan's always so smooth and fresh. Doesn't get stale or stick to the roof of your mouth. That's why it's always got that really swell peanut flavor. Right down to the last tiny smidgen way down there in the bottom of the jar. Yep, just you take one bite, and you'll know why Peter Pan's the favorite peanut butter of wide-awake guys and gals all over the country. And don't you forget, gang, Peter Pan's a real good energy food, too. It's loaded with the extra pep, the extra energy that you need to be a real top-notcher in games and schoolwork. So why not ask your mom to bring you some home tomorrow, huh? Then next time that you're kind of hungry, fix yourself the tastiest treat in the whole wide world. A sandwich made of Peter Pan, America's favorite peanut butter. Now back to Sky King in The Lady Sheriff. Now, minutes later, Sky and his friends are attempting to scale Rocky Bluff under fire. Penny and Lady Alice walk across the old mining camp toward a shaft leading deep into the bluff itself.
Oh, golly, I'm worried about Sky. The flying arrow was on fire.
If I know Sky King, Penny, he'll find a way to land that there flying contraption. Right now, we've got important work to do.
Hey, you mean that Trent is pulling a fraud?
Oh, sure as shooting, Penny. I smelled a rat the minute I laid eyes on him. That's why I brought Trent's diamond samples with me. Check them against any diamond-bearing rocks we might find here in the mine.
Oh, but if those diamonds are real, why would Trent give them to you to hold?
To fool the investors, Penny. Hey, $60,000 exchanged for several hundred thousand dollars from selling stock. Gives us time to finish here.
We're going down there.
The only shaft here not caved in. Come.
Can't we take this rail car to home?
No.
Take this rail car?
No. The dirt was I haven't. I've never seen that day where he couldn't take care of himself. Let's keep him take care of himself. Let's keep moving.
More moves, Sky. We'll have them on the open bluff. They won't be behind the rocks.
No, I think they've caught on to our tactics. Stay here, Tupper, and signal Jim to pepper away from where he is. I'm going up around him.
But, Sky, behind them is open clearing. They'll see you.
Trent's placed blocks of wood up there, so it'll look from the air like people are working on the bluff. I'll come behind one of those blocks.
Okay, but be careful.
I will. Now start banging away at them so they'll stay down while I go up. And wait for my signal before you and Jim move on.
All right, wise guys. Here's a little payment for shooting down the flying arrow.
Oh, gee, but this is spooky. With all that loose dirt overhead, it must be dangerous down here.
Yeah, it is. That's one reason they quit mining here over 20 years ago. Hold that light steady, Penny. I got to see this.
Wow. Are those diamond rocks? Gee, just look at them.
Yeah, there's diamonds in them, all right, but not diamonds like Trent was showing around for samples. These are low grade. Call them industrial diamonds.
Well, you mean to say the mine is worthless?
It ain't worth much. Industrial diamonds are used for precision instruments, like in that there watch you're wearing.
Oh.
Not enough here to make it worthwhile to work the mine.
Yeah, but where did Trent get the real diamonds he left with you?
Well, most likely he got them from a big robbery in New Mexico about 2 years ago, and we'll prove that next, now that we know this mine's a fraud. Come on, Penny, let's settle out of this mine shaft.
Not so fast, Lady Alice. You're going out of here all right, but not the way you planned.
Trent!
Don't reach for those diamond-studded six-shooters, Lady Alice. I have the draw.
Sky's on his way here. He'll fix you.
Yeah, Sky King is on the way here. Only we'll be ready for him. He won't fix anyone but himself.
That sky from the other side. He made it. Open up, Jim.
Right. We'll show these rattlesnakes a thing or two.
Okay, I give up.
Hold it, Jim, Clipper. Put your hands up down there.
Okay, just don't shoot.
Come on, Clipper, let's move in.
Careful, Jim. I see only one man.
I'm just waiting for those other polecats to stick their heads up.
All right, where's Trent? I don't know. He and Butch went back there someplace.
Who is this guy?
Well, whoever he is, he better tell us where Trent has gone and tell us quick. That's all I know. I fly the plane for Trent sometimes. Honest, mister, give me a break.
Yeah, we'll give you a break, all right. Here, Clipper, some rope I took from the Songbird. Tie him up good.
Right.
That's the idea.
There. That ought to hold him for a while.
Good. Now let's go into Rocky Bluff to find Penny and Lady Alice before Trent does, if he hasn't found them already.
Folks, they're coming. King of the Spales, right across the clearing for the mine shaft.
Good.
Let him come.
What are you planning, you no good lizard?
Easy, Lady Alice. Watch your blood pressure. We're not going to hurt him.
Well, you better not.
Come on. I'm in this cove here.
Here, we push these rocks supporting the big slab. Down it goes across the shaft. King will never get out.
Not one word out of either of you. But everyone gets hurt.
Lady Alice, what are we going to do?
There ain't nothing we can do now, child. Not with that gun pointing at us. But I want you to know, Trent, you are under arrest.
Get a load of the lady sheriff, Trent. She's arresting us.
All right.
Here they come. Remember one word out either. They get mowed down right where they stand.
I only see two of them.
Old man's missing. Probably left him at the top of the shaft. We'll take care of him later.
Don't quiet.
You think they're down here, Sky?
Well, they must be. Careful around this bend.
Can't get any lower.
That's funny. Shouldn't be far from the bottom of this shaft.
Not a sound or a light any...
Wow. What was that, Sky?
Come on. Let's go back and see.
Sounded like it was right around this bend here.
Yeah.
Golly!
A slab of rock. Right across the shaft.
Sky, we're trapped down here.
Sky, what in tarnation was all that racket down there?
Put your hands up, old man.
What? Trent?
I'll take that gun.
Penny, Lady Alice, what happened?
They caught us down in the shaft, Jim, and they've trapped Sky and Clipper down there with a big slab of rock.
Why, that dirty varmint child.
You'll just stay where you are, old man.
Don't worry, Jim. Someday we'll catch up with these crooks and we'll give them a real lesson in justice.
Well, Trent, we've got the diamonds and King's not going anyplace. What will we do with this kid, the old lady, and the old guy?
Don't you call me an old lady, you string bean with ears.
Quiet, you. We make it look like an accident, Butch. This old rail car here. If we released a brake, gave it a push down the shaft, what would happen?
Happen? Well, it'd be traveling a mile a minute before it hit that slab of rock in the shaft. Anyone can figure that.
Yeah, anyone can. Come on, folks. In that rail car, quick.
Why, you...
Don't, Jim. He's got a gun.
Get in there, all of you.
You'll pay for this sooner than you think, Trent.
More likely we'll collect, Lady Alice. Collect lots more money from the ranchers to invest in Rocky Bluff. Here, Butch.
Yeah.
Hold the diamonds and keep them covered while I give this car just the push it needs.
Let's jump.
No, no, girl. Sides of the shaft are too close.
Yes, we're going too fast to jump.
But when we hit that rock, we'll push it right through on top of Sky and Clipper.
Penny, Lady Alice, get behind me. At least we'll have some protection.
But, Jim, we'll hit that slab of rock going over 50 miles an hour. We'll all be killed.
You
know, gang, there's always one kid in every crowd who can keep going all day long like a hot rod racing car roaring down the track with the throttle wide open. And there's really no secret about it either. All that you need to be one of the top-notch kids in any crowd is lots of energy. And Peter Pan peanut butter gives you the kind of bodybuilding energy that you need. Why, sure, every time that you bite into a wonderful-tasting Peter Pan sandwich, you're loading up on the extra strength, the extra pep that makes you shine in sports and schoolwork, too. You're getting the kind of extra food energy that lets you go at full speed all day long. And another reason why Peter Pan peanut butter is America's favorite is just that it tastes of doggone downright delicious. It's got all of that real rich, nutty flavor of fresh roasted peanuts. It's so smooth it spreads like magic. So fresh, it melts in your mouth. And Peter Pan's special jar top seals that flavor in, so it stays fresh and smooth right down to the last bit in the jar. Yep, the best way to make sure of having plenty of energy is to make sure there's plenty of Peter Pan peanut butter in your pantry. There's smooth Peter Pan in the red top jar and Peter Pan crunchy peanut butter in the green top jar. So, why not ask your mom right now to bring you home a jar of Peter Pan tomorrow, huh? It's America's favorite peanut butter. And now back to Sky King and the Lady Sheriff. Jim, Penny, and Lady Alice, the fabulous Lady Sheriff of the Old West, are forced into a rail car on Rocky Bluff and are sent hurtling down a diamond mine shaft by Bruce Trent, a man working a diamond fraud on the ranches of Flint Ridge County. Meantime, at the bottom of the tunnel, Sky and Clipper are trapped behind a huge slab of rock that Trent has used to block the shaft.
Sky, what's that?
Hey, sounds like a rail car coming down those old tracks, Clipper.
Sky!
Listen.
Sky, get away from that rock!
Sky, that's Penny.
She's in that rail car. Jim and Lady Alice are probably with her.
They'll be killed.
And the rock will be pushed back to crush us.
Jump, and junipers, they're almost here.
Clipper, quick, use your gun. Shoot over this rock into that soft dirt on the ceiling of the shaft.
But, Sky, another 30 seconds.
Do as I say, Clipper. We might knock down that part of the ceiling. That way the car will have a cushion before it hits the rock. Start shooting.
Oh, Sky, what happened?
I think it worked, Clipper. I've moved the rock some. I think we can slip by now. There.
Yeah, but where are these guys?
Where are they?
Oh, you're all right, Jim. Here's Lady Alice and Penny.
I knew you'd come through, Sky, somehow.
Oh, I've never been so thankful for dirt in all my life.
Me too. Might never wash it off. How did you do it, Sky?
We shot at the soft dirt in the ceiling. It fell.
Them varmints are getting away, Sky. And the diamonds they got were taken in a robbery in New Mexico 2 years ago. I'm sure of it.
That's all I wanted to hear, Lady Alice. Come on, Clipper. Let's get after them.
How are we going to stop them, Sky? With our six shooters?
No, we'll stop them with the Songbird.
They're starting their takeoff. You're taxiing right toward them.
Hang on, Clipper.
We're going to hit him.
Not if I know Trent's courage. He'll turn away into the bluff.
Look out, Sky. We're going to hit him. They turned. Trent turned into the bluff.
Oh, I thought he would, but it was a pretty close squeak.
Look, Lady Alice, Jim, and Penny are over by Trent's plane. Huh? And Lady Alice has those diamond-studded six-shooters out.
She sure has, Clipper. And Lady Alice never misses. Trent won't cause any more trouble. Hang on, we're landing. Lady Alice, have your prisoners in tow?
Yep, I got them, Sky. Thanks to you. Neat bit of nerve work I've seen there. Feel years older just watching it, which makes me near 100.
Oh, Sky, you came so close to Trent's plane that I closed my eyes.
Mine ain't open yet.
Well, Trent and Butch better keep their eyes open and see all the free world they can while they can. Because for the next 30 years, all they're going to see is four prison walls.
So once again, Sky King wins out in his constant fight for justice. All of the grocers of America who sell Peter Pan peanut butter help make this program possible. Peter Pan outsells all others. It's America's favorite. Right, Peter Pan?
Right, Mike. Tell your mom to look for me in my bright green dress on the Peter Pan peanut butter jar.
Sky King, written by Dick Stenger, Sidney Renthal, and Fran Van Hartesfeld, features Earl Nightingale, Burl Vaughn, Jack Bibbins. Mike Wallace speaking. Listen Tuesday to Sky King. And the Mark of El Diablo. Kids, if you live in a television city, check your newspaper this weekend for time and station of the new Peter Pan television show for kids, Peter Pan's Magic Slate. This is the Mutual Broadcasting System.
And yes, that Earl Nightingale is the same one who was the motivational guru for a number of years on radio after this. Earl Nightingale, starring in Sky King. And I think Mike Wallace was also the same Mike Wallace that you saw on 60 Minutes for years. From 73 years ago, April 12, 1951, Sky King here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. We'll check in with Claudia and David in just a moment.
Instead of going down, the annual rate of polio cases in this country is going up. Instead of growing panicky with fear in the face of such an unwelcome fact, there is a way in which we all can join the army which is fighting to check this trend and ultimately defeat infantile paralysis. We can contribute to the March of Dimes. Give today so that the 1952 March of Dimes will be the biggest ever and a really potent fighting force against polio.
Now let's continue with the story of Claudia on Classic Radio Theater with this episode from 76 years ago today, April 12th, 1948, The Moving Men Cometh.
Your Coca-Cola bottler presents Claudia, based on the play and novels by Rose Franken. Brought to you transcribed Monday through Friday by your friendly neighbor who bottles Coca-Cola. Relax, and while you're listening, refresh yourself. Have a Coke. And now, Claudia.
David, what are you doing to Bluff?
Not a thing. He wants his breakfast. Bow wow. In case you missed the point, bow wow, I do too.
Rover, here, have some orange juice while I get the rest of it.
Roof, roof.
You do sound hungry.
Well, I'm not so especially hungry now. I'm merely trying to store up energy for the whole week.
What do you have to do this week that's going to require all this energy?
I am moving.
You?
Mm-hmm. Me and Bluff.
What about me? Are you going to leave me behind?
Leave you behind? Oh, I should say not.
Thank you.
But you're not going to help with any of the heavy work. That's man's work.
Bluff's not a man.
Well, he's man's best friend, though.
Oh. You are not going to lift a finger.
Well, not a finger, maybe, but how many trunks, sofas, armchairs, and barrels full of china?
Not one. It's all arranged.
That sounds ominous. What's all arranged?
You won't even notice that we're moving. It's all fixed. I did it Saturday while you were at the office.
What did you do?
Now listen, the moving men are coming on Thursday and take out everything except the beds. Then on Friday morning, they'll take the beds, and everything will be in Eastbrook before we even get there.
Is that so?
I just want you to know how efficient things can be. We're not even going to pack anything except our clothing. That goes by express, and we packed most of it yesterday. They do everything else.
Well, tell me, do they glue all the pieces back together when they get to Connecticut?
They are bonded.
Oh? What good is that?
Oh, I thought you'd know. Well, that's what they told me over the phone when I asked them what happens if something gets broken.
Who told you that over the phone?
The moving people. The carry-all moving people.
The carry-all moving people. Well, that's a pretty name.
Isn't it?
They carry all before them, I suppose, and leave nothing in one piece.
David, they leave everything exactly the way they found it.
Just the way they found it. Here?
No, in Connecticut, silly.
But they're not finding it in Connecticut. They're finding it here.
You are impossible this morning. Why don't you eat those eggs?
I am eating my eggs. But before I permit people to come in here and throw my possessions around, I think I have a right to know a little bit about them. Where did you find them, anyway?
In the phone book. Wasn't I smart?
Mm-hmm.
We pick up where you leave off. That's their slogan.
A fine slogan. What does it mean?
It means that they come in here, and if they find a towel on the towel rack in New York, they take the same towel, they hang it on the towel rack in the bathroom at Eastbrook.
Well, don't they send it to the laundry?
David, I don't think you really want to have moving people. I think you'd rather do it all yourself and complain.
Oh, you're all wrong, darling.
Good. Because they're coming up this morning to deliver the barrels.
What barrels?
For the good china and silver.
Well, thank goodness I'll be at the office.
David, if you're going in the bedroom, take Bluff with you. I want to clean off the table, and he's always getting in the way.
Come on, Bluff. Let's go. The ladies have taken over.
Bet you 20 cents you didn't know you had such an efficient wife.
I bet you I knew it all the time.
Do you really like it?
Like what?
Like me to be independent and efficient.
Of course I like it.
You wouldn't like me better if I were just flighty and female. David, you didn't answer me. The door. Must be the man with the barrels. All right, all right, all right, Mr. Carryall. I'm coming. Hello.
Do I have the pleasure of addressing Mrs. Norton? Mrs. Norton of 12C?
Yes, yes, I'm Mrs. Norton.
Good day to you, Mrs. Norton.
Good day.
I'm Olson of the Carryall Movers.
Hello, Mr. Olson. You brought the barrels?
The barrels for the china, silver, glassware, and other ends and odds, Mrs. Norton. All right, Samson, let's go. Samson is my assistant, Mrs. Norton.
How do you do?
Strong back, but not very talkative. Now, let's see, where's the best place to put those barrels?
Well, can't you put them in the spare room?
Lucky people, a spare room. That, Mrs. Norton, is fine for you. Fine for your friends. Excellent for your family. But for barrels, not so good. Oh. In fact, poor. Wouldn't you say so, Samson? He agrees with me, Mrs. Norton. Did you see him nod?
Well, no, I didn't. Oh, you can't leave them here, Mr. Olson. We're expecting company tomorrow.
We shall bend every effort to make sure that by tomorrow, the barrels are no longer in their present position. All right, Samson, take your mark.
But he's picking up the lamp.
Of course he is, Mrs. Norton. Samson is our lamp man.
But Mr. Olson...
Into the barrel with it. Oh, Samson. How often must I tell you not to drop lamps into a barrel?
Oh.
Lucky he didn't break that one, Mrs. Norton.
But Mr. Olson, I didn't think you were going to pack everything today. You were just going to leave the barrels here.
Uh-uh. Easy with the Crown Derby, Samson. What did you say, Mrs. Norton? Excuse me.
I said you aren't supposed to pack things today. You're not supposed to do that until Thursday. Mr. Olson, my husband's most important client is coming for dinner tomorrow.
Ah, that's the boy, Samson. Take it nice and easy.
But he's going right on packing.
Mrs. Norton, we have our orders. If you'd like to see them, well, here they are.
Where?
See? Right there.
Well... doesn't say anything about packing today.
My dear lady, you cannot expect to penetrate the code of the moving business. You see that little BQR next to your name?
Yes, I see.
Well, the B stands for barrels. The Q stands for pack immediately. The R stands for start moving out the furniture upon arrival.
But the people in the office said that
we... Ours not to reason why, Mrs. Norton. We merely bow in the direction of higher authority and go on about our business.
Do you mean you are going to move everything out today?
You see that little E next to the BQR on the orders?
I'm afraid to ask what that means.
Have no fear, my dear lady. Be a stout heart. The E stands for essential. We are to leave your essentials here until Friday.
What are our essentials?
Well, in the carry-all directive 32A, essentials are defined as... bedroom furniture, 3 kitchen pots, and enough china for the members of the household. You are 2, I believe.
4. We have a dog and a cat.
I am not supposed to consider animals, Mrs. Norton. But in certain cases, I manage to make myself look the other way.
Well, that's very nice of you. But why does it make any difference to the moving people whether we move today or Friday?
Madam, Operations Farm End, that's the name we've given a move in you, must be timed accurately in order that the final moves can be completed in accordance with a prearranged schedule. Easy with the Linux, Sampson. We want no casualties here.
I'm afraid I don't understand. But if you want to know what I think it's terrible.
War and moving, Mrs. Norton, are terrible things. But as we say, you can't make an omelet without breaking eggs.
This doesn't have anything to do with omelets that I can see. Except that you're all scrambled.
Look at it this way. This afternoon, we have 3/4 of a truckload empty, dispatched to Stamford, Connecticut.
Yes.
We're reserving that 3/4 of a truck for your furniture.
Mm-hmm.
Tomorrow, 1/8 of that load will be taken off at Stamford. Wednesday, the other 1/8 will go to Reading. And Friday, the remainder, your remainder, will be delivered on schedule in place in your house at Eastbrook, Connecticut.
But they promised...
At 0900 hours Friday, a truck will be here with 1/4 load empty. And that will take the remainder of your material directly to Eastbrook.
But they promised they wouldn't move anything out of here until Friday.
Well, they probably said that they would leave what you need until Friday. You'll be surprised how little you'll need.
But Mr. Carrington is coming.
Oh, Samson. Sometimes I think you lack respect for the finer things. Treat that Staffordshire as though it were your own, please. Discipline and taste is an essential to efficient moving, Mrs. Norton.
Mm.
Claudia, who have you been talking to? Oh, excuse me, I didn't know you had visitors.
Visitors? David, we've been invaded.
So I see. Say, where are you going with that china?
You too? I have just been explaining to Mrs. Norton that she's guilty of a slight misunderstanding.
Slight? David, they're going to move everything out of here today except the bedroom and 3 kitchen pots.
And the household china.
Well, now, see here, you're not supposed to be doing that.
Sir, I make you the same reply I made your wife. We have our orders. All right, Samson, start on the silverware.
I feel as if we were being undressed in public.
You're really planning to take everything out of here today?
Mr. Norton, Samson and I will have everything in the van by 1600 hours.
1600 hours? You sound like the Navy. You mean 4 o'clock.
We are like the Navy.
And besides, when you say we'll have everything in the van, I don't see you doing anything, Mr. Olson, except talk. Your assistant seems to be doing all the work.
The key to efficiency is to have sufficient supervisory personnel. Without me, the whole operation would lose its balance.
If you ask me, the whole operation has lost its balance already, and I'm losing mine with it.
Uh-uh. Easy with those pictures, Samson.
Oh!
Oh, Samson, really? One would think you have no aesthetic sense at all.
Well, if we want to get moved, I guess we'd better let them do it today.
I thought I was so efficient.
Darling, you didn't know you were fighting a civilian navy. As Mr. Olson would probably say, there is nothing to do but strike our colors and head back to port.
Then I ought to go down with my ship. All right, you win, Mr. Carry-All Movers. But just be sure it gets to Eastbrook by Friday.
Now, darling, you don't have to look so heartbroken. If I'd done it, they'd probably never got here at all.
I love you for saying so.
Let me put my arm around you, darling, while these vandals desecrate our home.
David, it's not just us. What's going to happen when Mr. Carrington comes to dinner? And when he sits down where there isn't a chair?
Well, don't worry about it, darling. Maybe they'll leave us an old crate.
Well, there's 3.
Every crate must be accounted for. But with 7,000 restaurants in the city of New York, why do you have to entertain your friends at home?
That, my dear Mr. Olson, at least, is not any of the carry-all movers' business.
All right, Samson. Now, let's get that barrel out of here. A 1, a 2, a 3.
Did you hear it rattle?
Then take it easy, Samson.
Look, it's not my intention to disrupt the natural affection between man and wife.
Well, that's kind of you.
But if you two would only step aside, we could get this container out into the hall.
Oh, I see. You want to move that container out into the hall.
That's
is that
right.
Correct?
Yes.
Well, Claudia, maybe we'd better just move over here.
All right,
out of
darling.
The way.
We'll move. Move. Did you say move?
I said move.
Oh, David, I don't ever want to hear that word again.
Many of the conveniences that have developed in America, we take for granted as part of our daily lives. One of these is certainly the Variety Store, familiarly known to you as the 5 and 10. This week, ladies, has been set aside as Nationally Advertised Brands Week in Variety Stores. So when you're wandering down the aisles of your favorite store today or any day this week, keep your eye out for brands with nationally advertised labels. And as you're shopping, I suggest that you pause at the familiar red cooler or soda fountain and refresh yourself with ice-cold Coca-Cola.
If you have a moment, Mr. King.
Why, yes, I do. What's on your mind, Mr. Olson?
Why, I just thought I'd advise you, Mr. King. If ever you are in the circumstances of moving, be sure to call the carry-all movers. Remember our slogan, we pick up where you leave off.
I'll remember that. Did you get David and Claudia moved all right?
As per schedule. Operations Farm End is underway.
Well, I don't know what they're going to do tomorrow, though, when Mr. Carrington comes to visit them.
Ah, Mr. King, as the poets have said, where there is a will, there is a way. And tomorrow, the Nortons will find a way. Oh, excuse me, I see it's 1400 o'clock. I shall have to bid you good day, Mr. King.
Good day, Mr. Olson. As I was about to say, every day, Monday through Friday, Claudia comes to you transcribed with the best wishes of your friendly neighbor who bottles Coca-Cola. So listen again tomorrow at the same time. And now this is Joe King saying au revoir. And remember, whoever you are, whatever you do, wherever you may be, when you think of refreshment, think of Coca-Cola. For Coca-Cola makes any pause the pause that refreshes. And ice-cold Coca-Cola is everywhere. These broadcasts are adapted for radio by Manya and Roger Starr, and the entire production is supervised and directed by William Brown Maloney. And now here's a word from your friendly neighbor who bottles Coca-Cola.
Ah, like the five and dime, the friendly neighbor who bottles Coca-Cola is gone from the landscape. But we still have these remembrances, don't we? 76 years ago, April 12, 1948, Claudia here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. Visit our webpage at classicradio.stream. Tomorrow we will have westerns, we will have crime drama, and we will have another episode of Claudia. And let's see, what do we know about Claudia tomorrow? Oh, we'll deal with Mr. Carrington coming to dinner, as was foreshadowed on today's show. That'll be coming up tomorrow. Have yourself a great day, and we will return on Friday with another podcast. On Saturday with another podcast. I'm Wyatt Cox, and thanks for being with us. This is Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox.